I forgot to do my swag slash memorabilia this week for my reaction video. So I'm going to insert this in and with my apologies, and I'll try to remember to do better next time. This is brand new swag. I received this unexpectedly in the mail last week. I just got a Together Again Tour 2023 tumbler. And tote bag. Talk about your unexpected, and it's cute too, and it's sturdy. I can't imagine I'll be using it for a lot of heavy duty applications because I don't want to ruin the swag, but it seems like it's very, very sturdy. I mean, it didn't fall apart when I just slapped it, so you know it's gonna carry a lot of stuff. It was a complete shock to me to get this. And then I vaguely remembered when I did the VIP package in Charlotte last May that they said that not all of the items that came with the VIP package were available. Either they ran out or they didn't never had them in the first place, and they said that they would send them to us. And of course, for me, the main reason I got the VIP package was to meet Janet. And so I wasn't even really concerned about whatever swag they were going to give me. And they did provide, they gave me a hat. I think the hat is, what's this, the hat? This is the hat. I got a hat, and then I got a Together Again t-shirt with the cover art from the original Together Again single, where she's got her hair in the different configurations. With the red hair and the praying hands. So I was good with that, and I totally had forgotten. And then suddenly, without warning, last week, 9 months later, I get these two other things in the mail. So I appreciate them following through, even though it was rather late in the process. So I was happy about that. So that's gonna be my swag, and I'm gonna insert this in the video, and then you're going to have everything you need for your Janet Jackson Friday this week, and you can sleep well tonight. Now let's go on to the official reaction for the week. Hello everyone, it's Micah. Welcome to our Friday reaction series, where it's all Janet, all Friday, all for you. Maybe I should have been saying that all along. Why would I not say all for you? It's a Janet reaction series, of course. So why wouldn't I? So, we are in the middle of reacting to Janet's second album, Dream Street, and we're taking it one track at a time. This week, we have the title track of Dream Street. The album Dream Street is my least favorite Janet Jackson album. I've had some harsh words for one of the tracks on this album, and I've had fair to middling comments on the other tracks on the album. The more I listen to the tracks, especially in detail, when I'm in situations like this where I'm sitting down and really ingesting the music and I'm reacting to it in real time, I find that I like the songs a little more than I let on. The issue here is that I listened to these albums for the first time years after I became a Janet Jackson fan. For me, the sun rose and set on Control and Rhythm Nation. And I don't remember exactly if I heard these first two albums prior to the Janet album from 1993, but they've always been sort of like apocryphal, is that how you say that word? Janet Jackson recordings. This was from the time in her life that was no very bad, no good. Janet, very bad, that no good, very bad 2 years of her life, or two albums of her life, where her father was her manager and she was not invested in her music. So you will see this reaction channel, or this reaction series, go in a very different direction once we hit Control, because this is music that really does live in me at this point. And I can still look at the other stuff, the older stuff, with a fair degree of detachment, because I never really fully accepted it into my life as a Janet Jackson fan. I know I'm speaking about it like it's a cult. But I say all that to say that the Dream Street album is not my favorite. The Dream Street song is also not my favorite. But as far as the Giorgio Moroder productions on this album go, it's probably the best one. And I'm not mad at this song. And it was a single off the album. And we do actually have a music video for this. This was Janet Jackson's first music video. And you would think something as landmark as Janet Jackson's first music video ever would be a big deal. But I had a lot of trouble finding it. I still didn't find an official version of it. I found a version on YouTube that has 36,000 views from a relatively small circulation YouTube channel that appears to be in from Europe, I think. So I'm not really sure why that is, and maybe I'll find out when I start running this through the copyright machine at YouTube and see maybe there's just restrictions because of the fact that this is footage from Fame. My exposure to the Dream Street video was from Video Vibrations, which was a music video show on BET in the 80s. And when Janet broke big, they went back and were playing this as sort of a throwback, say, hey, look at Janet and how far she's come. And they would play the Dream Street video. It's the only pre-control video that I'm aware of that exists. And I knew that the video was a Fame production where she used a lot of people from Fame. But in previewing this particular video on YouTube, I realized that it actually was a clip from the show Fame, something I never knew. I never watched Janet on Fame, and I'm not such a completist that I went back and watched all the episodes of Fame that she was in or anything like that. I may not have even seen the full episode of The Love Boat that she was on. So I'm not one of those fans, for better or for worse. I've always just really been more about the music. It was a revelation to me that this was actually lifted directly from a montage in the show. And I assume that they shared production costs on this, and they said, okay, well, we'll put this in the episode of Fame. It'll help promote your song, and you can also use it as your music video. So it was sort of a twofer. Because I've never seen this intro to the video. I think for releases of music video, they cut it off. They cut it off right before the part that's taking place in the real world in Fame, in the Fame universe, and they just showed the basically what I think is a fantasy sequence where she's imagining herself becoming a big star. At any rate, that's what we're listening to and today watching the music video / clip from Fame for Dream Street. Let's get started.
My name is Cleo Hewitt, and someday, just maybe someday, I'm gonna be a big star.
Dream Street! Dream Street!
I've always thought that this video shared a lot of similarities with the Donna Summer, She Works Hard for the Money, and we're about to get into the second verse where she inhabits that world of being an up-and-coming, or not an up-and-coming necessarily, but a starving artist trying to make it in Hollywood. And of course, she has the stereotypical waitressing job. Given Janet's family background, this does seem a little humorous and ironic, but she is playing a character, of course, here. And you kind of can't help but invest yourself in the foreshadowing, looking back on the clip of her saying, "I'm going to be a big star someday." And of course, we all know how that ended. And so it does seem prescient in a way. But at the end of the day, Janet was not invested in this performance in fame as Cleo. And so I think she did tap into, well, I mean, even if she weren't a Jackson, I think so many kids, so many young people have the dream of being a big star one day. It's crossed probably everyone's mind who's grown up in pop culture over the past 100 years, even if it was just a fleeting fantasy. I'm sure she used her acting muscles to tap into that feeling, but I don't think that there was, I don't think there's a lot of convergence here, anything special, but it is fun to watch Janet playing a character hoping to be a big star, if nothing else. The video is a nice production with a storyline, and for that I do enjoy the progression of it and the production values of it, regardless of how much that has to do with the fact that it was part of a TV show. But of course, it was, 1984. There was a certain amount of cheesiness in the graphics and the costuming. But I also think this is a fantastical, inside the character's mind kind of view of Hollywood, how Hollywood success would work out for her. So I think there's, as much as you want to attribute it to 80s cheesiness, I think there's also some built-in, some baked-in cheesiness based on what was going on in the character's head as well. As for the music, I think that the production here is great. The propulsive synths and everything it almost sounds like a pinball machine. And the other Giorgio Moroder Pippalot productions on here are uncharacteristically like boring and undynamic, but this one I think really could have been a hit. The suggestion I would have is that they're having her go through these really, if you really look at the lyric sheet for this song, there's a lot of great details in the song, but they're just having her go through everything so quickly, and they're laying the layers of music on top of her that you can't really focus on. You can hear what she's saying, but it goes past so quick that it doesn't give you a chance to really sink your teeth into the lyrics, which are actually quite nice for the song, detailing this young girl's journey into trying to be a big star. I think this song could have benefited from turning down the tempo just maybe 10 beats per minute and giving it a little bit more of a groove, and allowing her time to sing the lyrics with a little more feeling, so she's not just chirping them out as fast as she can because the beat is so quick. So I really would have slowed the song down. I think that, yeah, and of course no one asked my opinion on that, but I think that the song could have been more effective if it had been slower. With that being said, let's get back and watch the rest of the video.
I am confined in a situation she can't stand. I came to be an actress, but a waitress is all she lands. Her colors marked her through the wrinkles of her face. She came into this house and goes, she never got out of this place. She makes her mind up, she's gonna leave for 30 months. It's been so long now since she's felt that good inside. She calls to this line, there's a message meant for her. She's
street. Well, it's hard to find it.
And I'd never saw that ending part before. It always cuts out at the end of the video, at the end of the dream sequence, when I've seen the music video played, mainly, I guess, on that one show I was talking about. And so we get back to reality, of course, and this is all just a fantasy that she's having about becoming a big star. The video is cute. I have an issue with the choreography. I'm like, did they not know what they had on their hands there with Janet? Like, it just seems odd to me that they make this, they put her at the center of this huge production with all this dancing and this fanfare, and the best and the most complicated choreography they give her is to run at top speed up some stairs. So I'm just like, I'm thinking like, you all are kind of blowing it here. Even in this huge production, she's still just doing the shoulder bop thing that she's done for numerous TV performances. Like, will someone please give this girl some choreography already? And of course, when she finally got some choreography, then of course, you know, everything exploded. That's not the only factor that caused that to happen, of course, but I'm just wondering about that. I can't imagine that in the course of the series fame that she never had any choreography to perform. So I think I remember clips where she did, but why not in her own music video and her own big feature, why not give her some real dancing to do? That strikes me as odd. It was cool to see the cast members from Fame. I never watched Fame when Janet was on it. Because it was no longer on network television at that point. It was syndicated. I watched it the two or three seasons that it was on network TV, and I was a big fan of the show. But of course, I missed out on it once it went into syndication. And silly me, I could have had like all Janet all the time, which is of course become my life's mantra since then. But oh well, I missed out. Maybe I should go back and try to find those episodes of Fame and then go back and see Janet and all her performances. My objection to doing so, or the reason I really haven't made it a high priority, is like I said, this is the part of her life where she wasn't really at the helm of her career, and I don't really want to visit Janet at that point in her life and her career. I'd much rather see her when she's in control of things and when she's presenting the art to the world that she wants to, that she wanted us to see, that she really put herself into. And Fame, to hear her tell it, was like the absolute nadir of her professional career, where she was really just going through the motions, and probably the only time in her career where she was unprofessional. She admitted to just not showing up or showing up late for shooting, because she was going through so much with her marriage and her personal life in general, but I think mainly her marriage, which was a nightmare scenario for her. So I kind of do not, that's the reason why I don't really dwell on this part of her career. But you know, and those are all things that come to mind when I'm seeing all this Fame footage in the Fame regulars, Debbie Allen and what is his name? The one that played Leroy, is Anthony Ray, and the others, like the one that played her friend that got her the apartment. I loved her on Fame as well. It was good to see those, you know, those faces again. But yeah, in the context of the album, this is a standout track out of the Giorgio Moroder tracks. Unfortunately, all the Giorgio Moroder tracks are kind of in the back of the line as far as my personal ranking of the songs on the album. So this is the best of the worst, I guess you could say. But the lyrics on this one are probably the best lyrics on the record. It's a compelling story she's telling. Too bad they turn up the BPM so fast that it's, you know, you can't really hone in on the words. And they really didn't coach her And she didn't coach herself. Like, I'm not trying to just have her cede control of her vocals, but nobody, whether self-directed or anyone else, really coached her to really deliver these lyrics in a way that was truly convincing. She's just sort of like, she's singing them and she sounds fine, but it just, there's just not a lot of emotion there. You don't necessarily believe that she's emotionally invested in the song. And what kind of makes it worse in a way is that she's telling a third person story as opposed to making it about herself, or singing it in a way where you really believe that she's telling the story in third person but talking about herself. So it does, that removes a bit of the personal element from the song. It becomes almost on its face an impersonal song because she's singing about some random girl. It's obvious that she has empathy, or that she's supposed to have empathy, and she's going through the motions of singing with emotion, but they're just, it just isn't really there. I don't really feel it in the song. So all the elements are here, but they just didn't quite put them together to make a super compelling record. Shoulda, coulda, woulda, right? All right, next week we are going to move on to track 5 on Dream Street, and that one is another one of my favorites, I said with irony and sarcasm, communication. I have a lot to say about communication, and it's going to be nearly as much fun as my review of 2 to the Power of Love, so you don't want to miss that next week. So thank you for watching this video. Please like this video. If you indeed liked it, please react in however way you would like to react in the comments, hopefully favorably. Also subscribe to the channel if you feel so inclined. And finally, please continue to make music better. Thank you.